Tonight we head out on the highway and take the nation to the station as we go by road and rail. Let's meet my fellow roadies off the beaten track. It's Callie Beaton. Travelling down a B road, it's Aisling B. On a driving holiday, it's Holly Walsh. A blue whale of a time, it's Alan Davis. And their buzzers are really raily. Kelly goes.
See it.
Ashley goes.
Say it.
Holly goes.
Sorted.
Alan goes. Oh, okay. So I think you're going to be needing this. So this, rather pleasingly, it is a rail replacement buzz service. How cool is that?
That's very pleasing.
Yeah, I'll just back her up. Oh! Oh, Karen, do you want to be able to control it? No, that's a terrible idea. Isn't it great? Uh-oh. That cost $5.99, I'll have you know.
Thanks, Hal. Okay.
I love the fact it's called Topped Fig Transit, presumably because it's just about your size.
Yeah. Wow. OK, let's get the road on the show. In which country can you drive from East Coast to West Coast on Route 66?
Oh, no. Come on.
We're not going down there.
Everybody's done the show before.
Say it.
Yes.
America.
America, yes. Yeah, you'd think, right?
Yeah, because it's the answer.
This is the wrong answer. Mm. OK, so we want to drive from coast to coast. There is only one country with a coast-to-coast route 66. Any thoughts where it might be? Yes, Callie.
Armenia.
Armenia. Weirdly, is not a klaxon because we hadn't thought of it.
Australia.
Australia. No. France. Closer to home.
Ireland.
First person. No, closer to
Scotland.
Home.
Scotland. England.
It's the UK. Yes, it is the UK. Yeah.
What?
So the A66, which I'm sure you've all thought, let's take a driving holiday. It goes 115 miles coast to coast. It is from Middlesbrough in the east to Workington in the west. It passes through actually lovely places: Darlington, Keswick, Cockermouth. Sounds weird, doesn't it?
It does.
Yeah. Coming out of your mouth.
Out of my mouth. Rolls off the tongue, of course. You know the way in America people are always like, do you know what? Let's give up our jobs and go on Route 66 and take a car and just discover ourselves. It doesn't feel like people would be going like from Darlington to Cockermouth.
Yeah. Finding remote jazz clubs. Counterculture. Experimenting with new drugs.
We've been to every Greggs along the A66.
It's not the same since they shut the little shed.
So the A66 in 2018 was named Motorway of the Year.
Oh. But it's an A-road.
Thank you. Yeah. Yes. So, why might it suddenly be named Motorway of the Year, the A66?
Was it transitioning? Did it identify as a motorway?
Yes, weirdly.
Oh, that's it.
For one single mile, it identifies as a motorway.
Does it? That's all it takes.
It's A66 brackets M. For a single mile, and apparently in the great contest to be Motorway of the Year, that's enough.
Is it?
I know. The American Route 66, which we know about, it never ran coast to coast. Route 66 starts in Chicago, which is about 700 miles from the Atlantic, and then it travels through Missouri, Kansas, Oklahoma, Texas, and New Mexico and Arizona, all the way to Santa Monica in California.
I actually drove part of Route 66 with my children, and that is a lot of games of I Spy.
Yes.
I can tell you, it's a long road. But in Missouri, there's a fudge factory called Uranus. and they have, obviously, the usual welcome to Uranus. Life's pretty sweet in Uranus.
Oh, I need to go.
And then we got divorced a year later. Yeah. But it was a nice...
You and the children.
Me and the children.
They're still in Uranus.
There are some fabulous things to see on the way. There's a wonderful ghost town in Oatman, Arizona, where you can still see one of the former brothels. It's called Fast Fanny's. There it is. Here's the thing, Alan, that I discovered on the route that I think you would like, which is in Cartusa, Oklahoma. There was a guy whose wife collected miniatures of blue whales. He was a retired zookeeper called Hugh Davis, and for their wedding anniversary, he decided to make a blue whale that is 20 foot tall and 80 foot long.
Whoa.
Yeah.
For a wedding anniversary?
For a wedding anniversary present, yeah.
How disappointing.
I know. It took him nearly 3,000 hours to complete. Imagine the jobs he could have done around the house. Route 66, it was almost Route 62. It doesn't have the same... doesn't have the ring to it, does it?
No. You can't rhyme it with kicks, can you?
No.
You can rhyme it only with poo.
Yeah.
You call it Route 69. Although that would have gone from the top to the bottom and back again.
The road was officially removed from the US highway system in 1985 and replaced by interstate highways. But there are signs up now that say historic route or state route, that kind of thing. You can follow it. It's actually worth doing. It is a fantastic route. So many Route 66 road signs were stolen for souvenirs that in some places they painted the signs on the road instead. But what's the best way to stop people from stealing road signs?
Oh, I'm...
See you.
I'm from Dorset, North Dorset, 2 points, and there's...
I give out the points.
Well, I just didn't want to leave anything to chance. So I'm from Dorset, and there's a place called Shittington.
It's actually called Shitterton, yes.
Shitterton, even, yeah. Yes. And the local residents, so what they did was, because hilarious people kept stealing the sign that said...
There it is.
Oh, there you go, Shitterton. Oh. So they clubbed together, and instead of buying the people who were stealing the signs alive, yep, they decided they would buy a big, heavy rock-formed sign so no one could steal it.
Yeah, it weighs a ton and a half, and so far it's not gone. And I have to say they've done the same in the Austrian town of Fucking. But what they've done in America, particularly in one particular county, Colesville, Maryland, they've started taking the vowels out of signs. So anything to do with drugs, for example. So there was a place called Stoner Drive, and that sign kept getting stolen. It now looks like this. They've just taken the vowels out, and it stops people taking. The other problem is mile markers that say 69 on them. Those kept getting stolen. They now say 68.9. Just to keep them going. I tell you what, let's see how we are at road signs. Let's play What's That Sign?
What's That Sign?
OK, have a look at this first sign, and can you tell me what it is for?
Wobbly trucks.
Wobbly trucks.
Is it toasters in use?
So they did a survey by Quick Fit. They surveyed 45,000 drivers. 26% could not identify this sign. 100% of you on the panel. Anybody in the audience, put your hand up if you think you know what this is. Yes, darling, with the beard.
Adverse camber.
It is adverse camber.
Oh, wow.
Wow, I bet you're fun. Oh, yes, that'll be adverse camber. Yeah, that will be.
That's his safe word.
Adverse camber!
Just look like a town in Dorset, doesn't it? Oh, she's living in adverse camber at the moment. Try this one. What does this one mean? Anybody?
No waiting. Does it mean no waiting, sir? No. No, what's it mean?
Is that the Swedish flag?
No, the Swedish flag is blue and yellow.
I don't want to be shamed for just guessing, Sandy.
Does anybody in the audience... does literally nobody know what this is? Yes, a gentleman in the red shirt.
Clearway.
It is a clearway, absolutely
same
right.
Thing. Same thing.
Well, it means no... you can't even stop and...
Yes,
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 that's what he
yes,
said, no stopping.
No, you said no waiting.
Yeah!
No stopping.
Okay, you can't wait, you can't even stop.
No, you can't!
I'm going to give you an extra point so that you don't have a seizure.
Do you know Alan's the first person to get road rage sitting in a studio?
In the survey, 33% of people could not identify this sign. It is indeed a clearway. And the final one, let's have a look at this. Anybody know what this
sign?
Yes!
Is that one, don't take offence?
Don't take offence from the top of a barber's shop.
Anybody know what it identifies?
Is it to do with the level crossing?
It is to do with the level crossing. What do the bars below it mean?
I'm just trying to lip read the man in the audience who knows everything. His wife's having the best afternoon of her life. It must be nice to be out the house, is it? Yeah.
Hands up, anybody who knows what this one means.
I bet you whoever knows the next answer will have a white beard.
No stopping on the level crossing. No, is not.
You need a sign for that?
Yes.
Shall we? This seems like quite lucky to be parked so close to the station, actually. No, wait it!
There's a man over there.
Crossing in 200 yards.
Yeah, so it is. It's counting down the distance to the level crossing. Whoa. Very well done! Oh, yay!
Should have been christened the middle-aged white man round.
I know. That's extraordinary.
You're living in the middle-aged white man world, my
friend. From Rhodes in Britain to Rhodes in Greece, describe the pose of the Colossus of Rhodes.
See?
It's a sort of a man spread, a sort of Tory. like a sort of power stance.
Is it not there anymore?
It isn't there anymore, that is absolutely true. So we are trying to imagine what it would have looked like.
Oh, so every answer is right.
Except the one where it's astride the harbour.
I went to Rhodes once and they made a big play of this bloke used to stand across the harbour with his legs either side of the opening. So, you know, someone needs to tell them.
I know, it's a myth.
Ooh, that looks sore.
That does look uncomfortable. If the statue had been built over the harbour in that way, they would have had to close the harbour for 12 years, which... You know what construction's like. People going, oh, are you going to finish any day soon? Oh, I'll wait a little bit longer, get this thing.
Can't get his underwear on. We started it.
And then the statue, we do know, fell down in the earthquake of 225 BC, just 50 years after it was built. It was made of bronze sections. It had an iron and stone framework. It could not have been built with its legs apart. It would have absolutely collapsed under its own weight. There's also a clue in its name, Colossus. So Colossus was a particular type of statue that was found in Asia Minor, which always had its legs close together.
So it's like Angel of the North sort of thing?
Yeah, more like the Angel of the North. Exactly right, yeah. In fact, the harbour straddling idea came from an Italian visitor called Nicola de Martoni.
Sandy.
I know, right? Can I do the whole thing with an Italian?
Yeah, yeah, please. Do it, go on.
He said, the statue, the people told me, one foot... one foot on the wharf where the Church of St. Nicholas stands and the other end on the wharf where the windmills are. Thank you very much. Anyway, not only was this second-hand information, it was 1,500 years out of date, it's just, it stuck. There's that wonderful bit in Julius Caesar. Why, man, he doth bestride the narrow world like a colossus, and we petty men walk under his huge legs and peep about to find ourselves dishonourable graves. I mean, it's beautiful, isn't it?
We've all been there, haven't we? Mm.
Yeah. The things you can quote and the things I can quote are just totally different.
Not like,
I'm not a girl, not yet a woman. Of course, as Britney Spears once sang in her hit, I'm not a girl, not yet a woman.
If you have a look at the modern attempt, so this is a design they have thought many times to try and do this.
Oh, lads.
Whoa, that's very tasty.
If I saw that on a dating app, I'd be like, no personality. Come on, mate.
She'd go, what's in the bowl? What's in the bowl? £1 a guess, what's in the bowl?
Why would that be a desirable thing for ships to go under? Like, that would be... Wouldn't you just be like...
I think it'd be more fun if it was a bit like a thing where you'd come towards it and the legs open as you...
His cot was like a massive rope swing.
It's possible we've gone too far.
Every morning went, whoa!
I'm moving on. Britain is home to the world's oldest working model railway. It was first built in 1912, but what was the point?
Was it so a 10-year-old Rod Stewart had something to play with on his birthday?
There is an astonishing railway that Rod Stewart has built. This, which looks like a proper railway station with all the buildings, this is Rod Stewart's model railway, and he has been working on it for 26 years. He's handcrafted all the buildings, and when he's on tour, he has a special room set aside where he can build his railway.
Isn't it funny that someone who puts out so much sexuality can destroy it all with something so bad?
I also, it's good for the lady there with the road sign expert to know things could be worse.
Well, I absolutely love model railways, and I have a little train that runs around the skirting boards in my office. But after I saw Rod Stewart's, I realised that mine needs a little bit of work. So this is Rod's, this is mine.
I love that. That's amazing. So does it go right the way around your room?
Yeah, around on the skirting board. I want to get a bridge at the door that'll open and close like that.
A bridge at the door?
Yeah, so that you could open the door and the bridge would go up like that.
What about if you had a colossus with a swinging dick opening and shutting?
So let's go back to this particular railway, built in 1912.
Were they making a plan, designing something?
It is certainly to do with a plan. It was in use until 1995.
Was it a training device?
It was a training device. So at the Lancashire and Yorkshire Railways Signalling School at Victoria Station in Manchester, they used a model railway because you do not want to practice your signalling on an actual railway.
No. You wouldn't want to get the mistake there.
Did they have a model buffet car where they could practice saying no more cheese toasties after Milton Keynes?
So model trains are still used to train railway stuff. So TfL have a place called Ashfield House in Kensington, and the tube staff use
are model stupid. Look at them.
In the way.
It's behind you!
How to use the platform. What am I doing wrong here?
It's a mock-up of a tube station. It's called West Ashfield. It's on the third floor. Complete with tracks and signals and barriers and a train and so on. And they train 1,500 to 2,000 drivers and operational staff there every year. The very first model railway was built in 1859. It was built for the three-year-old son of Emperor Napoleon III. Le Monde reported... I should do this in French.
Oh, please do.
Sandy, take us on another journey.
Oh, la la. The railway, built for the amusement of the Prince Imperial, is a real toy, as well as a masterpiece of mechanical science. Its track is in the shape of the figure eight, the wit, and the caricature of its tiny rails is reminiscent of surprising curves of the railway.
Moving on, what's the secret to catching the invisible rail?
I'm 50. I'll take your silence as stunned. That's fine.
But no!
Thank you.
What? OK, let's do it again. Everyone's going to say no. Ready? Go ahead.
So, I'm 50.
What?!
None taken. So, but there was a man who said that women at 50 are invisible.
Not to men who are 54.
No. So I thought maybe it's a 50-year-old woman.
Well, certainly in a restaurant, that is true.
Yeah.
Have you tried popping one tit out and seeing if they can see where? Just the one. No need to come across as loose or fast.
Listen. Certain age, Ashling, they just sort of fall out and drag with you. You've got to be very careful for
them. Oh, like
not
you could pop it out under your
skirt. Yeah, anywhere you want.
You have to pop it out and then you have to go, oh, oh, oh. Oh, yeah, I'll have soup.
I'm going to ask again.
It's not the word for the overhead power cable, is it?
No, it isn't. In fact, we are being misleading with our illustration.
Oh, I think I know it. It's a bird.
It is a bird, you're absolutely right.
An invisible...
What's a bird?
Well,
rail.
So they're small, often rather dull-looking birds, frankly, but they live on the ground. They live in marshy areas in very, very difficult to reach.
I mean, that one's dead. You know that one's dead?
No. No. So these are the largest of the flightless birds. So it's probably about this big.
Cousin of a chicken, perhaps, Sandy?
Chicken is definitely bigger than that.
I meant to say it's the smallest of the flightless birds. With you, I'm still stuck on your tit coming out from under your dress. It's the smallest of the flightless birds, and one of the most elusive is called the invisible rail, so called because of its ability to hide in the long grass. There was a guy, a German biologist called Gerd Heinrich, and he's the very first person to have caught an invisible rail. And he said, I am solidly confident no European has ever seen this rail alive, and that requires such a degree of toughening and such demands on oneself as I cannot so easily attribute to others. And he wasn't exaggerating. So he went to this Indonesian island called Halmahera, and there's terrible, dense, bug-ridden thorn wilderness, and in order to get himself ready and toughen himself up, he rolled naked in beds of nettles. So, I know, he was keen. He was very, very keen.
Just shouting, Adverse Camber!
He left his pants on. Why, you don't want a nettle sting on your, on your penis.
Yeah.
I mean, you might as well just keep everything else on and just roll your penis in the nettle. Once you've got one on your penis, you're not going to think about any of the other... Just sting your penis and leave your clothes on.
If I was there, I'd just swing one breast into the nettles and we'd all be happy. Swing it! Ashley, we're not all 32 anymore.
Rails tend to live in places where human beings don't, because human beings bring dogs and rats and so on, so they tend to live in inaccessible places. Now, back to the railways. Tell me, who wouldn't be seen dead in first class?
Who wouldn't be caught dead? There's a clue in the question.
I dated a pilot for a bit, you know, an ex-Red Arrow, actually.
When you say you dated him for a bit of what exactly?
Well, I
Air miles?
I asked him once, I did say to him, will you,
Will you land?
Yeah. When we were in a bit of a saucy situation, I said, will you do the, pilot's voice? Will you pretend you're landing the plane? And he said, where are we landing?
And I said, Brazil.
He didn't enter into the spirit of things at all. He started asking if we'd had clearance from the tower.
Oh,
but he said
what's
to me...
What's it got to do with
the
railway?
It has got something to do...
Okay.
Well, I just thought you'd like that image. And then...
this whole show has been a delight for me.
He said to me that they have cupboards for if people die in the plane, they put them in a holding area, because people do die in the air.
And they put them in a...
They in a sort of, you know, where they might put your bags or your coat. They put cadavers. That if someone dies in
the
air...
they put them in overhead lockers.
They have a... Not, an, not overhead.
Can you imagine trying to stuff that, like...
That's impressive.
Whose bag is that?
I'm just trying to get
That's
my bag.
Another...
Until you get home, you're like, oh, I picked up a dead body, not my bag.
But we're talking about the railways. It was a specific railway that ran from Waterloo out to Brookwood in Surrey. Why would it do that? It's the largest cemetery in the whole of the UK.
Oh.
And there used to be the London Necropolis Railway. And it was built in the 1850s and it was to transport bodies out. They had a real problem with where they were going to put dead bodies.
I know, Surrey.
Yes, that's exactly. The churchyard of St Martin in the Fields was only 200 foot square, and yet it had 60,000 people in it, so they really
What?
Needed...
Is that the one off Trafalgar Square?
Trafalgar Square,
is necro dead people?
Yes, it is
necro. I recognise that from another phrase.
Yes. So the trains had first, second and third class carriages for the dead. The main sell of the first one was that your loved dead person did not have to be anywhere near a lower class person as they left London. Oh, it was opened between 1854 and 1941, an estimated 203,000 people made that particular one-way trip.
In coffins?
Yes, so there was a hearse carriage and then there was a mourner's carriage.
Hearst class?
Yeah, it was a hearse class. First and second class mourners had their own waiting room away from the third class, and then Anglicans and non-Anglicans had separate stations at the cemetery. And actors would always get off at the non-conformist stop because it was the only one that would perform funerals on a Sunday, and that's the only day that actors got the day off. And so they were buried in a special section on a Sunday. And now I'm afraid I'll have to railroad you onto the road to ruin that we call general ignorance. Fingers on buzzers, please. Have you got your bell? What is the most expensive metal on Earth? Yes.
I didn't mean to do that, it just went off. The most expensive?
Yes, most expensive metal on Earth.
I don't know.
I'm going to give 5 points for absolute honesty. It's one of the noble metals. It is incredibly expensive because it is both useful and rare.
Foil?
Yes, foil is a noble metal. Rhodium is the answer. So, for example, gold at the moment costs about $50,000 a kilo. Platinum is about $27,000 a kilo. This costs $350,000.
That sounds like something that a rapper would get his teeth done in
rhodium. For the sake of it. I mean, whether you could or not, I don't know. There's hardly any of it mined in the world. It's so expensive.
What's it used in?
Catalytic converters. About 80% of all rhodium is used in catalytic converters. The amount you'd have in a car, it's the same weight as about a quarter of what a postage stamp weighs, but it adds £70 to the price of your
car. So rather than nicking a car, all I need to do is prize it open, get the rhodium out.
That's what people do.
Yeah.
I had mine stolen.
What,
just for the rhodium?
The catalytic converter out of the car. They pull up with a power tool, they go underneath it, cut it off, and they've gone in 2 minutes.
Yeah. And you're just driving along?
No. You're not in the car, you've parked it, yeah. You've gone about your business, and when you come back, your car's going...
Are you going to start making them into, like, rings for weddings and stuff like that?
Well, yes, darling, because it is in jewellery, so it's used especially as a plate for white gold. It can give that sort of reflective surface, so it is used in that. It's also used in heart pacemakers.
They get nicked all the time as well.
Yeah.
Going about your business, 20 seconds later, they've nicked your pacemaker.
Right, moving on. How many terminals are there at Heathrow Airport?
Well, I'm going to say 5, and you're...
Alan, what do you reckon?
The 3 are on the airport itself. The other 2 are further away. Is that what it is?
No, it's that there are 4. There is no Terminal 1.
There's a sign.
Yes. the sign is incorrect. Terminal 1 closed down in 2015 and all flights were diverted to Terminal 2. It's sort of sad, really, because when it opened in 1969, it was the biggest passenger terminal in the whole of Western Europe. And by the end, it was sort of tragic. There were like 5 shops and 20 planes. And they did it to expand to Terminal 2, so there is no longer a terminal.
So when they're always on about building a third runway, they could just get the one out of 1.
But a runway and a terminal.
Yeah, just do that. Has anybody here heard of Terminal 6 at Heathrow?
Oh, is that the one you run at and if you're a wizard, you get through?
5.5.
Yeah. Supposedly reserved for famous people, royals, heads of state and
stuff. Have you been in it, Sandy?
I have never. It is a posh lounge behind an unmarked door in Terminal
Sandy,
5, apparently.
When you fly, do you get whisked off? Like, not with the normal people?
You have to pay. It's £2,750 plus VAT.
Could any of us get whisked for
anybody
two?
Could get whisked, anybody at all, as long as you've got the money.
So you pay that on top of your normal ticket?
Yeah. There's no shops there at all, but you know, big brands like Dior will bring stuff to you. And what I love is you get taken to the plane by a BMW.
So you have been whisked?
I've read and salivated. Right, let's look at the scores. Our winner today, leaving everyone in their dust with 9 points, is Holly! In second place, well, I'm not surprised, with 3 points because it was an excellent contribution. The audience! Yeah. In third place, with -9, it's Alan.
Third's not bad.
In fourth place, with -25, Aisling. And in last place, broken down on the hard shoulder with -30, it's Callie. Holly and Alan, and I leave you with this from one of the greatest motor racing drivers of all time, Juan Manuel Fangio. Driving fast on the track does not scare me. What scares me is when I drive on the highway, I get passed by some idiot who thinks he's Juan Manuel Fangio. Thank you and good night.